The thing about teaching fluids in introductory physics is that there are three main principles: Pascal's principle, Archimedes' principle, and Bernoulli's principle. In this video, I will show you six fluid experiments, two for each. Let's start with the definition of pressure. Pascal gives us the definition of pressure, that pressure is a force over an area. Fluids will flow from a place of high pressure to a place of low pressure by Newton's second law. And sometimes, because of an area difference, it is possible to establish a mechanical advantage, either using hydraulic, liquid pressure, or pneumatic, gas pressure. But pressure can also be measured by depth, and Pascal explains this too. P equals rho gh means that pressure doesn't depend on area, only depth and density. So we can use depth to predict pressure. And this is something that Torricelli explained. Torricelli found that the atmosphere was strong enough to lift a liquid mercury column to a height of 760 millimeters. But this was less so on the mountains. If instead you use water, you can lift it to a height of about 10 meters. Now, the ratio of 760 millimeters to 10 meters is about 13 to 1. Therefore, mercury has a density that is 13 times greater than that of water. And this brings us to number two, the concept of fluid density. If we are going to understand fluid physics, we need to use the MKS units of kilograms per meter cubed. I suggest a lab on these density cubes, which all have different masses despite being the same size. As a lab, try to measure the densities in the new units of kilograms per meter cubed, which turns out to be 1,000 times bigger than the units of grams per centimeter cubed. In the lab, you can try to guess which block is which based on their densities and comparing to a chart. For a liquids example, comparing the density of salt water to regular water can be done easily with a density manometer. It helps to keep the waters cold so that they don't mix quickly. The ratio is about 6 to 5 for fully saturated salt water. My favorite demo with the density manometer is to compare saturated salt water to pure acetone. These two liquids will not mix and are easy to clean. The ratio is a quite large 3 to 2. Thus, acetone has a density of about 0.8 or 800 kilograms per meter cubed. Number three, floating and buoyancy. You probably already know Archimedes' principle, that is, the weight of the displaced fluid is equal to the force of buoyancy. But this too is a consequence of pressure increasing with depth. That is, the deeper we go underwater, the greater the pressure increases. So the force on the bottom is greater than the force on the top, and these left and right arrows cancel out. The net result is that the pressure difference between the top and the bottom, rho g delta h, algebraically becomes equal to the net fluid force on the object. This is the buoyant force. Now, floating objects, of course, have a buoyant force that's equal to the weight of the object. So the buoyant force is indeed completely lifting the object. Here we see pine floats about halfway, while styrofoam floats about 90% above the surface. Ice famously floats about 90% below the surface, but it depends on whether the water is salt or fresh. Anyways, we can tell the density of an object based on how it floats. As a lab, consider this styrofoam boat, which will sink more as I add passengers into it. It will continue to sink until the density increases to be the same as the density of the fluid that it is in this case water. And once the boat has the same density as water, it finally will sink. Number four, Boyle's law. Whether or not the compressibility of gases is tested as part of your course, Boyle's law is still an appropriate lab for all physics students. Gases are an important example of fluids because we frequently use the volume of a gas under pressure as one of the ways in which we measure the pressure of a fluid. Adding books to this Boyle's Law apparatus is simply a great way to become familiar with the formula for pressure as force over area. Each book applies about 20 newtons, and the area is a constant 0.0004 meters squared. Both the Pascal as a unit of pressure and the pressure of the atmosphere can be measured quickly by this experiment. It's about 100,000 newtons per meter squared, and that value is something that all students should probably know. Number 5, the spouting cylinder. The spouting cylinder is a classic physics demonstration and a staple problem of AP physics. Holes at different heights allow water to be emitted at different pressure due to the depth from above. And the question you might ask is, which of these holes will emit water that goes the furthest? The upper spout has the height advantage, but the lower spout has the pressure advantage. The answer is to apply Torricelli's theorem. In short, the conservation of energy applies to ideal fluids. But when we combine the laws of projectile motion, maximum distance occurs when the depth of the spout is equal to the height of the spout, or equivalently, right in the middle. See the article below for the proof, or try to prove it yourself. Number 6, Bernoulli's principle. A fast-moving fluid is at a lower pressure. That is Bernoulli's principle. And it's found somewhere here in the Bernoulli equation. The principle explains the airplane lift force, that there is air moving faster over the curved wing's top than on the bottom, and this generates a pressure difference, which causes a net force upward. That's the lift. But a more readily available hands-on example is a Frisbee. The Frisbee displays a similar curving to the airplane's wing, and this obeys the principle in the same way. For this demo to work, you first need to explain that Frisbees, when thrown through the air, are seen to float easily because the air is moving faster over the top than the bottom, and that generates the same lift as the airplane's wings. The purpose of the spin of a Frisbee is to keep it in the same orientation as it moves through the air, and this always keeps the air on the top moving faster. So, yes, play Frisbee with your students. But going further, let us now ask, what if we glued two Frisbees together in sort of a macaroon shape and tried to give that a throw? What would Bernoulli have to say about that?